We have two different approaches to structure of quasicrystals, and one is the so-called inner space description or higher dimensional space description, and then we need the atomic surface. The second description is a real space statistical approach, where we have a probability distribution, and we can call it as an average unit cell. What is the high dimension? The high dimension for a Fibonacci sequence, for Fibonacci chain, we have a periodic two-dimensional structure. We have a physical space or parallel space, and then we have an inner space or perpendicular space. And then everything which is in a strip can be projected into physical space, and we obtain the sequence of distances, which are called, if it is given by number which called the golden mean tau, then we have a Fibonacci sequence. And the atomic surface is that bound from here to here. The atomic surface for the Penrose tiling is much more complicated. You can see four pentagons and two extra points. The average unit cell is a probability. For example, for one-dimensional structure, when you have arbitrary structure, arbitrary positions of atoms, you can superimpose the periodic reference lattice. The periodicity is given by a scattering vector k. And then calculate the shortest distance of this atom to the reference lattice. This distance is called u. In my calculation, we will use the probability of u and v. And v is the second distance to the second reference lattice, which is given to the scattering vector q. So we have two scattering vectors, k and q, and then we calculate the shortest distances of the structure, of the position, atomic position, to the reference lattice points. And it is easy to show that the structure factor, when it's a Fourier transform of this probability for the object which we called average unit cell, this object is limited to the wavelength which are connected to the k and q. So average unit cell is a probability distribution of atomic distances to the reference lattice points. And the atomic surface is also a kind of average unit cell, but written in the inner space, in the Park space. Now we have the atomic surface in a high dimension, and we have the probability distribution average unit cell in physical space. And what is the relation between these two elements? One can easily prove that when we have an atomic surface and we choose the scattering vector k, this is this direction, k, and if we project this atomic surface perpendicular to the k vector, this is this direction, and the trace of this projection is an average unit cell. So in that sense, average unit cell is a projection of the atomic surface to the physical space. We can also say that atomic surface is an average unit cell risen up to high dimension. So if a structure can be described in high dimensions, The two approaches are completely equivalent. We are talking about the same. But of course, there are many structures which cannot be described in high dimensions, or for some structures we would like to refine it not in high dimensions but in real space. This is a two-dimensional representation of the Fibonacci chain, and this distance is an atomic region. So this is a probability distribution in physical space. An example. This is for Fibonacci chain. We have a diffraction pattern, which is given here. And if you calculate the probability distribution for a particular k vector, k0 vector, you will get the rectangular distribution. And you have to now to Fourier transform this distribution, which is quite easy to do. And then you will get the intensity of all the diffraction peaks, which are given by this periodic series. This means that for the Fibonacci chain, the diffraction pattern is quasi-periodic, is not periodic, but still we have periodic series of peaks, and this series given by this relation, so all higher harmonics, can be described by the same average unit cell, by the Fourier transform of this average unit cell. We have chosen this scattering vector, k0, but we will get intensity for all high harmonics. And the intensity are calculated correctly. There is no any kind of, application, some kind of methods which are not correct. This is strictly valid theory that when you calculate the average for the K0, you will get the intensity for all higher harmonics. But you can see that it is not enough. For one K0, you have only a few peaks which can be described. You need another K vector. So single distribution is, however, insufficient for the reconstruction of the whole diffraction pattern. We need another scattering vector. So let's say this is a K vector, the previous one. This is the high dimensional representation. We have the atomic surface over there. And we project perpendicular to that vector. This is this direction. So we project the position on the average unit, on the atomic surface on top of the real space. And we will get the position u. Now we have to find another vector, q, and do the same. So we project perpendicular to this q vector. We project on top of the physical space, and we will get another distance v. And you can easily recognize that from this direction, you immediately get the point on an atomic surface. So either we are discussing about the atomic surface or this distribution given by these two variables. Every type of atomic surface can be reconstructed by the two projections of the physical space which gives average unit cell. Okay, now we know that they are completely equivalent and we can forget about the high dimensions and work only in physical space having this distribution. Of course, the distribution is given in the space U and V, and you will get on this space you will get a function which gives you the distribution. But for quasicrystals we are very lucky, because this distribution is not zero only along this line, because we have scaling. Scaling is the most important for quasicrystals. If we have scaling, the distribution is zero everywhere, but along this bound. So everything reduced to the Fourier transform of this bound. We have a rectangular distribution along this direction, and that can be done even by hand, so everybody can do it. This is the Fourier transform of rectangular distribution, is sinus phase over phase, and then put it to square, you will get the diffraction part. So now it looks the following. We use k zero vector, this is this part. We obtain this function which describes all the periodic series of diffraction peaks as previous. Now we use another vector q. I use this q vector. And we will get the periodic series, another periodic series, I call it the first satellites. And then you can have all higher harmonics, so you will get the second satellite, the third satellite, and so on and so on. And you can easily recognize the diffraction pattern of a Fibonacci chain consists periodic series of diffraction peaks and the satellites. Unfortunately, the satellites are incommensurate compared to the diffraction to the main peaks, so the diffraction pattern looks very complicated. But it is simply Fourier transform of this rectangular distribution along this. For example, if we use modulated structures, this is a simple example of harmonically modulated structure, when we average the distribution P of over U looks like that. It's not more rectangular, it's like that. And the full distribution in U and V, now it is not as previously a straight line, but there is a more complicated line, some arcus sinus or something like that. But still, this is a line. And now to calculate the diffraction pattern of modulated structure, you need either this distribution, this one, then you will get all this periodic series of the main reflections, or you need this distribution, then you can also calculate the first satellites, the second satellites, and so on and so on. So the whole diffraction pattern can be, of course, described in high dimension as it was done by Janner and Ted Jensen and De Wolf, but you can do the same calculation in physical space. You have to Fourier transform the average unit cell, which looks like that. If you, for example, complicate the structure, we have 3Q structure, so you can see that we have a component Q and then the 3Q component. Then the average looks more complicated, and in the U and V parameters, the lines is, it is a composition of two arcus sinus or something like that. So it becomes more complicated, but if you perform the Fourier transform of this line, you still will get the main reflections, and then the first order satellite, the second order satellite, and so on and so on. And nothing is left. Everything, each peak is calculated correctly. Oh, now comes the Penrose tiling. For Penrose tiling, the distribution is more complicated because, as you have seen, in high dimension, the atomic surface consists of four pentagons, two big pentagons and two small pentagons. When you have a oblique projection, then the distribution looks more complicated. But still, if you use, for example, a long x direction, use this k vector, you can see that there is almost nothing. There is almost no intensity. The intensity is very, very low. But it is still enough to describe all the periodic series of a diffraction peaks. Because Y is nothing else, so Y is nothing. If we calculate the same distribution along the Y direction, it looks like that. And here I use the K vector given by this value, and you can still see that there is almost nothing after that. But these two vectors are enough to reconstruct the whole diffraction path. What is even more important, of course, if you don't know this distribution, this very funny shape, you can simply calculate the approximation by Gaussian function. If you calculate the fit to this distribution, a Gaussian function, it's enough. It's enough to reconstruct the diffraction path. Because the diffraction pattern mostly depends on phases, not on the amplitudes. So amplitude can be described by the Gaussian approximation, and then we know correctly the phases, and we can construct the diffraction path. And how does it look like? This is an average unit cell, now calculated in two dimensions. It looks like that. For this particular K vector, of course, if you change the K vector, you will get another average unit cell. Because this is the starting vector. And then if you calculate Fourier transform this distribution over this average unit cell, you will get the diffraction pattern, which is exactly the diffraction pattern for Penrose diagram. So now we are operating only in this average unit cell with these distributions. We can conclude that the whole diffraction pattern is reconstructed by a periodic distribution function, which is called average unit cell. And this distribution is given only in physical space. This distribution can be also obtained by, of course, by two projections of atomic surface, as I showed before. So you can project it from higher dimension, but you can also calculate it in physical space. There is no single spot of diffraction pattern which could not be described by average unit cell. So full diffraction pattern, even the diffuse scattering. It's not only the Bracco reflections, also the diffuse scattering can be described by average unit cell. And it is given here, even the background is accurately described by this approach. So we are not only calculating the Bracco reflection, we are also calculating the diffuse scattering, which is not possible, very difficult to be calculated in high dimensions. And here it comes immediately. So now we come to the real structure, so let's try to decorate the Penrose tiling. We have to find one point from this tile. I took this point from S and L. One point of a single tile, and then find the distribution of this point in parameters u and ux and ui. And if you calculate it for the large and for the small rhombus, you will get such shapes. How to do it? Of course, you can project it from high dimensions. Here you can see this pentagon of atomic surface, and part of this pentagon is belonging to this distribution of particular point. Only part of this. This can be obtained from high dimension, but of course, especially for the computer scientist, it is easy to calculate it. You have your Penrose tiling given in positions are given in on a computer. Just to calculate the probability distribution, you will immediately get a rectangular shape. This one and that one. So we know the distribution of a Penrose tiling for single point, for zero. Of course, you can choose another point zero,
but not necessary to use that one. And then you can calculate the structure factor, which looks very similar to the ordinary crystallography which we have. That means this is some amplitudes and phases. When you decorate each rhombus by NL, each big rhombus by NL atoms, you have phases of this position, and small atom, small rhombus can be decorated by NS atoms when you have these phases. And this one, this function, is a Fourier transform of a rectangular shape you got from the distribution. So there is nothing new. For quasicrystals, there is nothing new. It's only this parameter, which are a Fourier transform of a distribution of particularly chosen point. Of course, when you get another tiling, you will get another distribution, and you will get another Fourier components. But you can try as much tilings as you like, and as much decoration elements you can use in your computer, it doesn't matter. So let's see some examples. So in principle, we have a structure factor which is calculated in this approach. We know how to calculate it. We know it analytically. So now we can perform the refinement. The first refinement was done and presented during the ICQ conference at Zurich. And we use the data of Hiroyuki Takakura. This is a decagonal cobalt-rich structure, nickel-rich structure. Diffraction, okay, we use 69, as a decoration, we use 69 atoms in 19 groups. And there was 261 independent reflections. And the results you can see here. And the fit looks very promising. So now we use the structure factor derived in every June cell. And we have a decoration of a rhombus. Try to keep the distance that it is the distance between, because we expect that the atoms are not closer than special distance, and try to put the atoms, decorate the rhombus, the S and L, L and S, and then try to fit the positions. And as you can see, the fit is very good. And the results are very similar to the high dimension analysis. There is no difference which you can recognize. The second example was also for aluminium, for nickel rich decagonal phase. Then we use the data from Zurich, and it was much richer diffraction pattern with almost 3,000 symmetry independent reflections, and 106 parameters in 24 groups of atoms. And that was presented at Liverpool periodic conference. It looks like that. It's almost perfect. You can see that we are using the data. This is 100%, this is the highest intensity peak, and then we have three order of magnitudes lower diffraction data. So the peaks are almost not seen on a normal scale. And this is a decoration we can obtain on different Z. And the fit looks also very promising. And the last example, which was presented at ICQ 11 at Sapporo, the last conference, this is also with the Zurich group. This is an Edagawa phase. This is a superstructure type 1 of aluminium nickel cobalt.
This is a concentration. I'm not going to the details because I'm going to show that it works and is very useful. Now we have a 97,000 reflections, and we have this is a very dependent reflections, and we have okay, divided into main reflection satellites, and okay, we can fit with diffraction data, and it looks like that. This is a decoration. Now we have two type of rhombuses, because the method does not depend on how many types of tiling are using. You can say, okay, let's say we have 10 tilings, 100 tilings, it doesn't matter. It works, you know, automatically. So now we decided to have two types of tiling, which are depends on orientation. They are almost the same, but symmetry related slightly, so tile A and B. And this is the results. Few details of the algorithm. Together we fitted 700 parameters. In everything is in a real space. There is no high dimensions, and of course the results. The results are also very promising, and you can see the structure with different tiles. So now we have not only the two type of rhombuses, but also the orientation of rhombuses taken into account. So it looks very promising, and everything has been done in a physical space. Of course, you can also refine it and to see the clusters, the 12 angstrom, the 20 angstrom clusters. Oh, this is a dataset of the fitting. I show that you can refine the structure in a real space, and the refinement does not differ from the normal crystallography. We are only saying that there is no periodicity. So instead of particular positions, we have a distribution. We have a distribution of probability distributions, and then we can calculate and refine the structure. So where we are now? We know the structure factor for decorated panel styling. Of course, if somebody would like to have some other decoration, but it's quite easy to get it. Yeah, and it was already adopted to refine the decagonal quasicrystals. We also know the structure factor for the clusters. I will show it just in a moment. So we can also refine the structure using a cluster approach. And we soon expect the structure factor for decorated icosahedral quasicrystals. So also this class refined in a physical space. What are the clusters? Maybe most of you know the Petra Gumelt cluster, the black cluster, which is consists of 33 atoms, and then the panel style can be described by this cluster. In my case, this is 2B cluster, and not very comfortable, very, very uncomfortable. It's much better to use the kites. The smallest kites is given is that one. We call this a kite K number 4 because it consists 4 atoms. The second is the green one, which consists 7 atoms. And the third one is K17, it consists 17 atoms. And now what is the problem with the clusters? The problem with the clusters is the following, that the clusters start to overlap. You can see if we use clusters K4, then we have to overlap between two clusters. Of course, this is also for K7. So we have overlapping clusters. And when we have overlapping clusters, okay, there's no time maybe to show that. This is the biggest cluster I use. This is K17. We have 17 atoms described by 1, 2, 3, and so on. And it looks like that in the colors will be described in the next slide. Okay, what is the problem with the clusters? The clusters, for example, the decagonal clusters, tetragonal clusters, you can see that they overlap, very heavily overlap. And the thickness of covering for the tetragonal cluster is more than two. So each point is covered more than two clusters. It's too much. If we calculate it for the kite clusters, the thickness of covering is only 1.17. So only 17% higher than one. Now you should calculate the distribution of average unit cell for particular atom in these clusters, and here it was done by computer. But you can easily recognize the atomic surface, the projected pentagon from high dimension. This is a big one and this is the small one. Okay? The results are similar, but if you don't know the high dimensional method, you can do it by computer and you easily get that this shape should be rectangular. And now you can Fourier transform it and calculate the diffusion part. What can we get from the cluster description? Now we have only one element, cluster. Let's say K7. So we have a kite with seven decorated atoms, or K17 with 17 decorating atoms. Not only we have the position, but we can also calculate the concentration of atomic position. For example, for the K17 atoms, we have seven independent atomic position with a concentration given by these numbers. For the K7, we have only three position with a concentration given by this. For the tetragonal, we have also three with a concentration. And for the K4, we have only one position, by no other way, which is 100%. What does it mean? For example, if you have a concentration, nominal concentration of your sample, and you are lucky, and you know the clusters, and you try to adopt it to fit it to the concentration, you can find the cluster, the proper cluster. My conclusion is, the structure refinement of quasicrystals can be done in physical space using the average unit cell. Can be done, and it was shown that you can do it easily. Average unit cell can be easily supported by higher dimension analysis and the projection method. Of course, if you know the higher dimension and you know that the structure can be described in higher dimension, because in my opinion, many structures cannot be described, or we have many problems with description, or we have to add some phonons, phasons, and so on and so on. If you know this, then you can use a higher a projection method. Within the average unit cell approach, we can go beyond quasicrystals. Not only quasicrystals, but also more complicated structures, even the amorphous. We can go continuously to amorphous or to liquids, because there is no difference between diffuse scattering and Brock peaks. We are calculating the whole diffraction. Thank you very much.